This is the Texas State Sports Network from Learfield, IMG College. HEB is proud to present Inside the Lines with Texas State head coach Jake Spavital. No store does more than my HEB.
We're going to win. We're going to win games. We're going to win championships. We're going to win bowl games.
Welcome to Inside the Lines with head coach Jake Spavital. I'm your host, Brant Freeman. Coming up, we look ahead to the Bobcats home opener versus the 1-0 Wyoming Cowboys. But first, we kick off this week's show by looking back at the 2019 season opener from Kyle Field.
The Jake Spavital era begins in College Station with more than 98,000 on hand as Texas State takes its shot at number 11, Texas A&M. After the two teams exchange punts on the first possessions, the Aggies piece together their first scoring drive of the game, marching 72 yards in nine plays, capped off by a 21-yard strike from A&M quarterback Kyler Mond to receiver Courtney Davis, putting the Aggies on top early 7-0. The Bobcats pick up a first down in the ensuing drive, but the drive ends with a turnover. An interception thrown by Tyler Vidd that sets up A&M inside of Texas State territory. Following a 40-yard completion by Maud on 3rd and 9, the Aggies officially capitalize off the turnover with Jayshon Corbin punching it in from a yard away on 3rd and goal as A&M grabs a 14-0 lead. We head to the second quarter and the Aggies take advantage of another short field, having to go just 40 yards on their third scoring drive of the game, with Maud taking it in himself for A&M's third touchdown of the night. Texas State's next drive features two completions to Hutch White for first downs, but ends on another turnover as Miles Jones intercepts Vitt and returns at 14 yards. Five plays later, the Aggies are in the end zone again, and it's Corbin's second touchdown, putting A&M on top 28-0. The Bobcats make a change at quarterback, but Gress Jensen's second pass of the game results in another turnover as the Aggies come up with the third interception of the half. Texas State's defense, though, comes up with a turnover of its own, a fumble right at the goal line recovered by Frankie Griffin, and the score remains 28-0 A&M at the half.
Fires has a man wide open at the 5, going for the goal line, trying to reach out. Is the ball loose on the turf? There's a scramble for it.
The Aggies' first possession of the second half suffers the same fate, a turnover right at the goal line, and again courtesy of a Bobcat linebacker as Brian London comes up with a one-handed interception, the first of his career.
I'd always questioned his hands for the longest time, and you know, he tried to do a one-handed interception in practice earlier in the week, and he dropped it, and he actually caught it in the game. So I take everything back what I said about him out there in practice. So I'm pleased with how he played. You know, it's probably a good moment for him. Because that was a hell of an interception. You know, that the guy was open in the end zone. You know, Kellen just didn't put enough air on it, and you know, Bilo ended up getting it. So you know, I got to look at the tape and see how he was running with the football. It didn't look too athletic, so that's probably the next thing. It's probably the next thing I need to discuss with him. But pretty happy for Bilo.
Fast forward now to late in the third quarter, and A&M on top 31-0 and looking for more. Isaiah Spiller breaks free but is eventually caught from behind by Deshaun Waddy. That 85-yard run by Spiller is part of a big night on the ground for the Aggies, who ran for 246 yards in last week's opener. After Mond throws his third touchdown pass of the night, A&M takes a 38-0 lead early in the fourth quarter. And later, with a score 41-0, the Bobcats start to string together their first scoring drive of the season. Jensen finds his rhythm and later finds Trevis Graham in the end zone at a 27-yard touchdown. The first touchdown pass for Jensen is a Bobcat and first touchdown catch for Graham.
Well, we started to actually execute the things that we were doing, and we just kept stubbing ourselves on the toe. And early in the game, we had some really nice things called, and we got caught up in the moment on the big stage, and guys were just mentally busting, and we had some really good stuff. And then once everybody kind of calmed down, things started to happen. We still made a few mistakes to keep us out of the end zone, but finally that last drive, it looked like what we wanted in our offense, and we made a big play at the end, and underthrew the ball a little bit, but TJ came back and made a great catch.
The final score from Kyle Field, Texas A&M 41, Texas State 7.
Not the way the Bobcats wanted to usher in a new season, but brighter days are ahead for Texas State football, perhaps as soon as this Saturday when the Bobcats host the Wyoming Cowboys. Coming up next, we'll talk more about the game this Saturday with head coach Jake Spavital and also look back at the game versus Texas A&M. Back with more Inside the Lines right after this.
The 2019 Texas State football season is presented by HEB.
We, the people of Texas State University, united to create a more perfect future. We are the people who make this community a place we're proud to call home. Our ingenuity creates opportunities, turning great ideas into actions and actions into achievements. We are family, and together, we'll do more great things than you can imagine.
I'm Brett Ramsey. I've worked at HEB for over 40 years. Here, our team developed the Cody brand. These are coolers and tumblers that really stack up against other high-performance brands. They're as tough as Texas and perfect for all the things we love. And made with the highest quality at the best price, or we wouldn't put the HEB name on it. So enjoy keeping it cold without getting burned by the price. This is the Cody department at HEB. No store does more than my HEB.
When you're ready for a car that's kayak friendly, or you're just ready for a downsize, we approve. UFCU, with rates that challenge the big guys and people who understand your journey. We have auto loans for whatever life you want to live. Apply today at ufcu.org/myauto.
Hear that? That's 50,000 Texans. That's how many of us pick Texas Oncology every year. Every one of us has a story. A story just like mine. About being so much more than just a patient. So start your story with Texas Oncology and see why they're my team.
Welcome back to Inside the Lines. We're now joined by head coach Jake Spavital. And coach, let's first start by looking back at the season opener versus Texas A&M. You played in front of a crowd of more than 98,000. That is the largest crowd this program has ever played in front of, not to mention the national TV audience back home watching. So how do you feel as if your players handled themselves playing in front of such a big stage?
I thought we handled it pretty well. You know, typically in your first game, just kind of knocking the rust off of just the off season, and you know, there's a lot of chances for a lot of penalties. But I thought our kids were very disciplined. I thought they played hard. I thought the elements didn't distract them at all. So just for our first game together with a new coaching staff, I was very pleased with how we just operated in general.
In the lead up to the season, we've been asking you many different ways about the feeling of going from offensive coordinator to now head coach for the first time. So that was your first game as the guy on the sidelines. What was that moment like for you?
I enjoyed it. I did. You know, never thought once about calling plays. You know, it was more about, you know, just the game management. Had a bunch of dialogue going on with our special teams coordinator, talking with Coach Stitt and my brother Zach just about where they were at and where they stand. So I thought our communication for a first-time staff together was very solid. And, you know, never looked twice about, you know, calling plays. It was just more about making sure we're putting our kids in the best position to have success.
Now, A&M won the game, yes, but you made your fair share of plays. You look at the defense in particular, you got two turnovers right there at the goal line. One of them, a one-handed interception by Brian London. Not a bad way for Bilo to get his first pick.
No question. You know, I thought the defense played extremely well. It did. We put them in some tough situations, especially with field position, their backs against the wall. But I thought they responded very well. Those two goal line stands were pretty crucial because that game could have really got out of hand, but they kind of held their own and ended up getting a fumble and an interception. You know, Bilo, remarkable one-handed catch. You know, I always laugh because he dropped that, you know, earlier in practice throughout the course of the week. He goes out there and ends up having a great interception, and I think he's pretty feeling confident about himself right now.
Now, you look at the box score, and one of the big plays for A&M was the 85-yard run the Aggies had in the third quarter, but what some people might overlook is the fact that Deshaun Waddy made the tackle before he scored. What does a play like that tell you about your team?
I thought they fought till the end. You know, they didn't give up on any plays. You know, a lot of teams would allow that guy to go ahead and score that touchdown, but you know, Nick Daniels and Waddy chased him all the way down and got him down to the ground. You know, there was that's the one play that we wish we probably had back defensively, because majority of the game they were shutting him down pretty well. You know, and to just for the first time to flip the field position in the second half, and then they had that big run, but you still see the fight and you see those guys hustling to get it down, and that's something I can live with as a head coach, and understand that the culture that we're creating here is about effort and playing disciplined football, and I think we're on track for that right now.
Let's now look at the play of your quarterbacks from this past Thursday, and it was about equal time for your top two signal callers. Tyler Bitt started the game, played a majority of the first half. You handed the offense over to Gress Jensen late in the second quarter. He finished the game from then on out. So looking back at their play, what was your evaluation of the quarterbacks last week?
I thought they both were just okay. You know, I thought they both had a little nerves when they were out there, which, you know, it's tough. You know, I get that. It's a tough position to play. You've got to orchestrate the whole offense and put us in the right positions and execute. But I think when you look back at both of them, they both had their highs and they both had their lows. You know, the one thing that we've got to eliminate is turnovers, you know, and those four turnovers put our defense in a pretty tough predicament throughout the course of that game. But you know, it's back to the drawing board. We got to just keep developing these kids and understand that they both are capable of doing this. They just got to execute it. They just got to calm down and put the ball in play.
After playing such a talented and physical team like Texas A&M, how thankful are you that the game happened on a Thursday, giving you a few more days to get ready for another tough opponent like Wyoming?
Yeah, I think it's great. You know, having 10 days off for your next opponent, it gives you a few more days recovery. And when you play SEC opponents, those are very physical games. And I could just we got them up here the next day on Friday, and we practiced them and we worked them out to get out that soreness and just kind of check as a team where we were at from a health standpoint. And we came out of that game pretty healthy.
Now, we're going to get more in depth on Wyoming later in the show, but I want to take a quick glance at the Cowboys with you. You mentioned playing an SEC opponent. Well, last week, Wyoming beat one. They hosted Missouri and beat the Tigers in Laramie 37-31. So what are you up against this Saturday against Wyoming?
You know, I think we're up against a well-coached football team that plays extremely hard. You know, they are the definition of efficiency. You know, that's they are very unique ball control. They're going to hold the ball as long as they can. They're going to try to dictate the pace of play, and that's something that we got to focus on and try to get them out of their comfort zone. But you know, I would expect these guys to come in with a pretty good demeanor about themselves after a big victory over Missouri, and I think that our guys are ready to match what they're doing and go out there and try to beat them at their own game.
All right, Coach, good luck.
I appreciate it.
All right, still more to come here on Inside the Lines. Coming up next, we'll visit with offensive coordinator Bob Stitt. Stick around. We have more Inside the Lines coming up in just a moment.
Hey, Bobcat fans, for all things Texas State football, be sure to follow us online and through social media.
When the Bobcats made a coaching change this past offseason, one of the goals was to bring in somebody with a strong offensive background, which certainly fits the bill for the newest head coach in Jake Spavital. And the newest offensive coordinator, his resume is even longer when it comes to coaching offense in college football, Bob Stitt.
You know, I think the main importance of bringing Bob in was just his overall experience as just a coordinator and as a head coach. You know, he's been at programs that he's done more with less, and that was something that has always been intriguing with me. He's always putting his kids in the right positions to have success, even though they're not as talented as the opponents that they play. And it was a no-brainer for me to call him up as one of my first calls to come join this staff, because a guy that's been calling plays for 30 years, I think he's has a pretty good understanding and feel for how this game's supposed to be played.
Well, we've come a long ways, and when we got into spring early, we couldn't execute anything, and we continued to come along. Our assistant coaches have done a great job with each one of their positions moving forward, but you know, now it's getting them to execute. Our players are playing very hard for us, and you know, you really have something if your team will play hard. Now we've got to get them to just focus and execute the plays, and we're going to really have something nice on offense. We're going to spread it out, and the base concepts of my offense was West Coast, and I'm a lot older than Jake, and a lot older than a lot of these the air raid guys, and so we took the West Coast concept, spread it out, then we started using the fly motion, which put some pressure on the defense a little bit. So we're just trying to make the defense create problems with their eyes with this fly motion, and make them defend the entire field. And we're going to always have a complement to everything, and put guys in conflict where we feel like they can't be right. Well, they got to process information, and there's certain places to go with the ball. They can't try to do too much. You know, that we try to teach them what the defense is doing, where their weakness is, and just go put the ball there rather than trying to worry about too many things. You know, so we want to be efficient, and we want to always put the ball where it needs to go. If that's a handoff, if that's an RPO, if it's a deep ball, whatever it is, we want them to always be putting it where we want it to go.
Jensen, play action, firing downfield, looking for the end zone, looking for Graham, goes to his knees, catches a touchdown, Bobcats!
The Bobcats' final drive of the game this past Thursday in the season opener, Texas A&M, was a touchdown drive, and the Cats hope to carry that into the home opener this week against Wyoming. For Inside the Lines, I'm Brant Freeman.
The Inside the Lines Coaches Interview is presented by HEB. No store does more than my HEB. Play the HEB tailgate toss by texting HEB to 83200 for your chance to win groceries for a year.
We, the people of Texas State University, united to create a more perfect future. We are the people who make this community a place we're proud to call home. Our ingenuity creates opportunities, turning great ideas into actions and actions into achievements. We are family, and together, we'll do more great things than you can imagine.
My name is Mark, but around HEB, they call me the boss of the sauce. My job is to travel Texas, looking for the best salsas and sauces. After tasting lots of options, we want to try some new flavors. And that's how Mark's Good Stuff got started. These are unique products with delicious ingredients. They're inspired by Texas taste and everything I loved about growing up around here. Like this salsa, named for my old high school football number. This is the Taste of Texas department at HEB. No store does more than my HEB.
There's been a lot of talk this season about Texas State's veteran defense, but did you know the Bobcats also have a lot of experience on offense? From offensive lineman Aaron Brewer to running back Anthony Taylor to senior wide receiver / punt returner Hutch White.
It is a rugby-style punt, and White will field it on a bounds at the 28-yard line. He's got space across midfield. Punter to beat, running left inside the 30, tripped up, down to the Aggie 27-yard line. Farley brought down to the play by Elon Anderson. What a return by Hutch White.
First thing is, you know, you got to catch the ball first, you know, get the ball back to the offense. But whenever you see that opening, you know, it's like your eyes just become really wide, and you just want, it's awesome to hit it. Yeah.
A wobbly punt, and it is hauled in by Hutch White at the near sideline. 40, 45, midfield. Hurdles the punter inside the 45 and down to the Tiger 43-yard line.
You know, he plays the game the way you want guys to play it. And he goes 1,000 miles an hour, and he's fearless. And, you know, if you could find 11 guys to put out there, you know, every single play that played with the same intensity and love for the game that Hutch does, you'd really have something.
Play fake, the sophomore throwing it near side, man open, Hutch White, the catch in stride, inside the five, runs into the end zone, touchdown Texas State.
I think Hutch is one of our most consistent players. You know, like, he is a guy that everybody's comfortable with throwing the ball to. He's a reliable outlet all the time, and, you know, he's got a little bit of a savviness to him to make some plays. You know, not just from an offensive standpoint, he's such a reliable guy from a punt return standpoint as well, which, you know, that's one of the more difficult things to do, and he can catch balls in traffic, and, you know, he's just a very consistent person, and I think he's a guy that we're going to rely on for the rest of the season.
Second and 11, handoff to Taylor, flips it to White, throws back to Vitt, the catch at the 30, at the 20, inside the 15.
Coming in, I wasn't really as familiar with Coach Stitt as well as with Coach Spav, but after being around him in the spring and the summer and then now during the season, you can really see how, like, wise he is with everything and how he really picks at the little things. You know, he doesn't like to do a lot, but just focusing on the little things to get you open. You know, you don't know when your last play is ever going to be. And, you know, I'm not probably the most talented guy out there, fastest or strongest, but, you know, I'm going to give you my all every play. So just having that edge on people.
TSA bringing a blitz, they'll rush six. Vitt throws into for White, makes a catch. Touchdown, Texas State.
It seems like every year there's a new addition to Bobcat Stadium. Last year was a brand new video boards. This year, the latest add-on is a nod to Texas State football history. It's a history that includes 14 conference championships, the first three won in the 1920s under legendary head coach O.W. Strand. That was followed by 9 Lone Star Conference championships at the Division II level, and then a pair of Southland Conference championships at the FCS in 2005 and 2008. The highlight of Texas State football history came in 1981 and 1982 under longtime head coach Jim Wacker, who won back-to-back national championships those two seasons, his Bobcat teams going a combined 27-1.
Play UFCU Spin to Win by texting UFCU to 83200 for your chance to win $1,000 in cash, Texas State gear, and other cool prizes.
We, the people of Texas State University, united to create a more perfect future.
We're the people who make this community more than a school. It's a place built on collaboration.
We are people with great ideas and ambitions,
with talent and dedication.
We're turning ideas into actions and actions into achievements.
We empower and inspire each other.
We spark innovations that change lives.
Our ingenuity creates opportunities.
We are the people of Texas State University. We are a family. And together, we'll do more great things than you can imagine.
This week's breakout performance of the game is presented by Texas Oncology.
Play fake, fires over the middle, intercepted by the Bobcats in the end zone. Out over the 5 to the 10, tripped up Brian London with the interception.
Welcome back to Inside the Lines. Last week, the Bobcats opened their season against Texas A&M. This week, it's a home opener as the Bobcats host Wyoming, marking the fourth meeting between the two in the last 9 seasons. Here to preview the game with us is a man we know very well, Dave Walsh, the radio voice of the Wyoming Cowboys, kind enough to join us yet again in previewing Texas State versus Wyoming. And Dave, let's start Well, the Cowboys started the season, a 37-31 win over the SEC Missouri Tigers. Not a bad way to start Craig Bowles' sixth season there in Laramie.
Oh, it was a big win for Wyoming. It had been a long time since the Cowboys had beaten a Power 5 conference team, and they played a great game. Got down early 14-0 to Missouri, but then came storming back, had a big second quarter, scored 27 points in the quarter, and then just kind of hung on in the second half. But just a big, big win for the Cowboys and great way to start the season, obviously.
Now, Dave, dating back to last season, that's 5 wins in a row for Wyoming. So just how significant was it for this year's team that last year's team won its final 4 games after starting 2-6?
Well, that was a great comeback and a great end of the season last year. And Cowboys got themselves bowl eligible and didn't get a bowl bid, but it has carried over. They talked a lot about the way they finished the season last season during the spring and during the fall drills. They talked about trying to carry that over, and they certainly did. I think the one thing, too, that jumped out, too, Brent, is that the fact that the Cowboy quarterback, Sean Chambers, he kind of came on at the end of last season but then was hurt in the last game of the season. And he is the starter now. He's a redshirt freshman. He got that redshirt year last year after playing in 4 games. But he has come back, and he was just so outstanding in this game against Missouri, and particularly running the football. You know, he ran for over 120 yards, scored a touchdown, had one 75-yard touchdown run that really broke the game open. He's a big factor, and he was named a team captain by his teammates. He's just a redshirt freshman, first freshman ever at Wyoming to be named a team captain. So he's a big part of what's going on here, and a great leader, and he had a great game last Saturday night.
That's a look at the offense. Let's now talk about the defense. It forced 3 turnovers in the win over Missouri from this past Saturday, and the Cowboys have been really good at forcing turnovers over the past several seasons. What's your scope on this year's defense under first-year defensive coordinator Jake Dickert?
Well, I know just taking off that first game, a bend but don't break, obviously, type of defense, although they did score 31. They got those takeaways, a couple of them, down in their own end as Missouri was going in. So, I don't know. Opportunistic, I guess, is what I'd say about this defense. So they came up with those 3 takeaways, big, each and every one of them, obviously, key to how this game turned out. Gave up a lot of yards, but still made some big plays.
Dave, I said it earlier that this marks the 4th meeting between the two programs since 2011, and the home team has won this game fairly convincingly each of the previous 3 meetings. So what does Wyoming have to do in the matchup this time around to become the first road team that's victorious in this series?
I think just do what they like to do. They've got to execute in the running game, which they did against Missouri. And I guess continue being opportunistic on defense. And Wyoming has a great kicker, special teams player of the year last year in the Mountain West Conference, and Cooper Roth has just been automatic. So, he's got to make his kicks. But I think the Cowboys, the first and foremost, what they want to do, what Craig Bolt has always wanted to do offensively, is run the football. We run a pro-style offense, but it's so geared toward that running game. And if the Cowboys can have success in the running game, then it makes it a lot easier for them. They have a better shot of coming out on top, that's for sure. So I think they'll be dedicated to the run, and that means the quarterback will run the football. Chambers is an outstanding runner. He's still developing as a passer, but he's an outstanding runner. So I think if Wyoming can get the running game going and then just kind of hold down the Texas State offense, then they'll have a pretty good shot of winning the game.
All right, Dave, thanks. And that's going to do it for this week's show. Don't forget, next week we look ahead to an in-state showdown as Texas State travels to Dallas to take on SMU. Until then, I'm Brant Freeman, reminding you to unleash your battle cry. We'll see you next time.
This has been Inside the Lines with Texas State head coach Jake Spavital, presented by HEB. No store does more than my HEB. This is the Texas State Sports Network from Learfield, IMG College.